Good evening, everybody. My microphone must be on because you're getting quiet, so that means my microphone is working. Thank you all very much for coming. My name is Tom Morgan, and I'll preside over this event. This is an annual affair. I've been doing this for now, this is my 26th year of hosting these lectures, and it's a privilege to do it and a delight. These whole lecture series, all of them, are sponsored by, of course, the Allworth Center for the Study of Peace and Justice here at the College of St. Scholastica, and funded in part by the Warner Lecture Series of the Manitou Fund, the DeWitt and Carolyn Van Evre Foundation, and by Mary C. Van Evre in memory of William Van Evre, a former trustee of the college. Additional support has been received from Reader Weekly of Duluth and from numerous other private donors. Thank you all, from the Allworths to everybody, for continuing to support these lectures. As you all know, I'm sure, the topic for this year is religion a force for good or ill? And of course, by that we mean a political or social force. This is not a series of lectures about theology. This is the first, as I said, of four. Our Auric Alprin Interreligious Forum is also doing a series of programs speaking about social action or being in the world from the point of view of one's faith. So I won't talk much more about that because I want to talk about tonight's lecture. But information about all these activities are on our website or in material available in the lobby. And speaking of the lobby, there's a sign-up sheet if you want to be on our mailing list, or keep track of us on our website. Anyway, the information is out there about all the lectures. We started something new last year that I thought worked very well. After the lecture, we will invite you to ask questions, and we'll invite our speaker to give answers. But we would like to have you all defer to the students. The rule is students go first, and when the students have asked their questions, then if there's time, you are all very welcome to ask questions after that. But we want to make sure the students get their chance. This is really why we're all here, as you all know. After the lecture and after the little reception we'll have out there and some book signings, I want you to know that we have another opportunity the following week to get together, for those of you who are interested. As you regulars know, we like to have these talk-back sessions in which we discuss the lecture and what we've heard with the help of somebody who knows a thing or two. And I think I found somebody who knows a thing or two, and that is my colleague Denise Starkey, head of our Theology and Religious Studies Department. There's information about her and about where the talkback session will be held next week. Monday, 7 p.m., Mitchell Kitchenette, which is right outside the foyer there in that direction. So please come back at 7 o'clock and for more interesting conversation led by Denise Starkey. I think that's all the housekeeping I have for now. So let's get on to business. Our speaker this evening is the director of the Center for World Catholicism and Intercultural Theology at DePaul University in Chicago. He has done his academic work at Notre Dame, Cambridge University, and Duke University, where he earned a PhD in religion. His areas of specialization are in political theology, economic ethics, and ecclesiology. Before he enrolled in his PhD program at Duke, he worked as a lay associate with the Holy Cross Order in a poor area of Santiago, Chile. And he worked at the Center for Civil and Human Rights at the Notre Dame Law School. Much of his work is focused on how worship can be a political act in response to a totalitarian regime. And our speaker has written extensively about how church worship practices offer meaningful alternatives to globalization and consumerism. The titles of his recent books provide a key to understanding what he has spent much of his professional life thinking about, and here they are, in the reverse order in which they've been published. Migrations of the Holy, God, State, and the Political Meaning of the Church. The Myth of Religious Violence, which is the topic of tonight's talk. Third book, Being Consumed, Economics and Christian Desire. There's also Theopolitical Imagination, Christian Practices of Space and Time. And finally, Torture and Eucharist, Theology, Politics, and the Body of Christ. His books have been translated into French, Spanish, Norwegian, and Polish. In addition to these works, he has collaborated on several other volumes, and he's written many, many journal articles, and he is editor of the journal Modern Theology. By the way, before he joined the faculty at DePaul, he taught at the University of St. Thomas in St. Paul. So Professor Cavanaugh knows his way around Minnesota. He currently lives in Chicago with his wife, Tracy, who is a social worker. Their household includes their boys, Finian, 16, Declan, 14, and Amon, 11. When he's not thinking and writing about religion and theology, our speaker brews beer at home and takes part in a variety of athletic activities with his boys, football, soccer, skiing, and hiking. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Professor William T. Cavanaugh.
Thanks, Tom, for that kind introduction. Thanks to all of you for being here as well. Thanks to the Allworths for underwriting this lecture series. I met Royal and Karen at dinner and also shared dinner with Denise Starkey. So thank you all for your hospitality and warm welcome since I've been here. It's been great to be back in Minnesota. I love Minnesota. I wish I had time to go to Betty's Pies. That's my only regret. But it's really nice to be back here. The last time I was here about 5 years ago and I talked about torture. And so this time I'm going to talk about religious violence. So maybe next time we can do something happier. Maybe I'll talk about beer brewing or something like that. Thanks. So I was out for a walk recently, and I came upon a very distraught man who was about to throw himself off a bridge. And I said, wait, don't do it. There's so much to live for. Do you believe in God? And he said, yes. And I said, me too. Are you a Christian or a Jew? And he said, I'm a Christian. And I said, me too. Are you a Protestant or a Catholic? And he said, I'm a Protestant. And I said, me too. What kind? And he said, Baptist. And I said, me too. Are you a Northern Baptist or a Southern Baptist? And he said, Northern Baptist. And I said, me too. Northern Liberal Baptist or Northern Conservative Baptist? And he said, Northern Conservative Baptist. And I said, me too. Northern Conservative Baptist Great Lakes region or Northern Conservative Baptist New England region? And he said, Northern Conservative Baptist Great Lakes region. And I said, me too. Northern Conservative Baptist Great Lakes Region Council of 1879 or Northern Conservative Baptist Great Lakes Region Council of 1912? And he said, Northern Conservative Baptist Great Lakes Region Council of 1912. And I said, die, heretic, and I pushed him off the bridge. Not a true story. But that joke by Emo Phillips was recently named the funniest religion joke in the world. And I think the fact that it was named the funniest joke about religion kind of tells us something about the way people ordinarily think about religion, right? It's a particularly kind of divisive and vociferous force and so on. I gave a lecture at a college out east not too long ago. And the title of the lecture was "Does Religion Cause Violence?" And on my way to the lecture hall, I saw a poster for the lecture, and somebody had scrawled the word "duh" over the poster. And I thought, yeah, that pretty much kind of sums it up. So everybody knows, right, this is a kind of common folklore. Everybody knows that religion has a dangerous tendency to promote violence. And that is part of the conventional wisdom of Western society. So what I call the myth of religious violence goes something like this. Religion is a transhistorical and transcultural, meaning it's there in human history at all times and places, a human impulse that's essentially distinct from so-called secular ideologies and institutions. Secondly, religion is more prone to promote violence than secular ideologies and institutions. And therefore, religion should be marginalized from public power, and we should fight to defend and spread secular ideals. So in post-9/11 discourse in the US, this story tends to color the way we view the rest of the world. We tell ourselves that we live in a peaceful, secular type of state in which religion has been tamed in the public sphere, while those people over there, Muslims especially, right, still mix religion with politics, and that makes their politics peculiarly volatile and dangerous, right? So their violence is religious, and therefore it's irrational and divisive. Our violence, on the other hand, is secular and rational and peacemaking, and therefore, you know, we find ourselves regrettably forced to bomb them into the higher rationality, right? So this evening I'm going to challenge that conventional story, and I'm going to argue that there is no essential difference between so-called religious and secular ideas and practices. So there's no good reason for thinking that so-called religious ideas and practices are more inherently prone to violence than secular ideas and practices. And thirdly, then, the idea that something called religion is essentially prone to violence is an ideological justification that can be used to justify the violence of so-called secular orders. Now, if all that sounds complicated, let me put the thesis in simpler terms. People kill for all sorts of things. That's it. People kill for all sorts of things. People are just as likely to kill for their country than for a god, maybe more so. And the reason is that the nation state, in some contexts, has taken the place of God. So American Christians, for example, are far more likely to kill on behalf of the state than on behalf of Jesus. Now, let me be clear that I don't at all deny that Christians and Muslims and others can and do use their faith to justify violence. So I'm not arguing, for example, that you hear sometimes that violence of these sorts of people is really political and not really religious. What I deny is that Muslims or Christians or Buddhists, their violence is of an essentially different and inherently more troublesome nature than violence in the name of supposedly more mundane and secular realities like kings or nations or flags or freedom or oil. And the idea that there is something called religion that it is more troublesome can and is used to promote violence on behalf of secular nation states like our own. Okay, so I'm going to start then with the idea that there's this essential difference between religion and the secular. The famous atheist Christopher Hitchens' best-selling book, God is Not Great, which is subtitled with typical British understatement, How Religion Poisons Everything, right? In that book, he points to histories of abuses by Christians and Jews and Muslims and Hindus and Confucianists and Buddhists and so on. But at some point in the book, he also faces up to the fact that atheist regimes like those of Joseph Stalin and Kim Jong-il are responsible for tens of millions of deaths and uncounted suffering. And so Hitchens deals with this problem by declaring that atheist regimes like Stalin's are religious too. He says totalitarianism aims at human perfection, which is essentially a religious impulse, according to Hitchens. So basically, religion poisons everything because everything poisonous gets labeled as religious. Right? At the same time, everything good ends up on the other side of the religious-secular divide. Here's what Hitchens says about Martin Luther King. In no real as opposed to nominal sense, then, was he a Christian. And he bases this remarkable claim on the notion that King was nonviolent, and so therefore he couldn't possibly be religious. So what's not violent can't possibly be religious, because religion is defined as violent. Now, at this point, we could just dismiss Hitchens as being peculiarly confused, and we could assume that, of course, everybody knows Stalin is not really religious, he's an atheist. And we could start arguing over who caused more deaths in the 20th century, atheists or people that believe in God and so on. But that would be to assume that we really know what religion is and what religion is not. Hitchens is useful because he shows that what counts as religion and what doesn't is very fluid and often depends on the political agenda that one is pursuing. So Hitchens is by no means alone in this. If you examine arguments that religion causes violence, you find that what counts as religion and what doesn't is largely incoherent. So let me give you some examples of this. I go through 9 different examples in the first chapter of the book. So Martin Marty, preeminent historian of religion in the US, University of Chicago. In a book on public religion, Marty argues that religion has a particular tendency to be divisive and therefore violent. But Marty then lists 17 different definitions of religion. And then he says, well, I'm not going to give a definition of religion, since he says scholars will never agree on the definition of religion. And so instead, he gives a list of 5 features that mark a religion. But he says it's not a definition because we can't define it. He then proceeds to show how politics fits all 5 of the same features. So he says religion focuses our ultimate concern, and so does politics. Religion builds community, and so does politics. Religion appeals to myth and symbol, and politics mimics this appeal in devotion to the flag and war memorials and so on. He goes down the list. So he offers 5 defining features of religion, and he shows how politics fits all 5. What he's trying to do is show that religion and politics are deeply intertwined, but what he ends up doing is demolishing any theoretical basis for separating the two. Another example, sociologist Mark Juergensmeyer, his book Terror in the Mind of God is maybe the most widely influential academic book on religion and violence. And according to Juergensmeyer, you'll hear him on NPR a lot. Religion, according to Juergensmeyer, exacerbates the tendency to divide people into friends and enemies, good and evil, us and them, by ratcheting divisions up to a cosmic level. But then he's forced to admit the difficulty of separating religious violence from secular violence. Here's what he says. Secular nationalism, like religion, embraces what one scholar calls a doctrine of destiny. One could take this way of looking at secular nationalism a step further and state flatly that secular nationalism is a religion. Now, that's an important concession, as is his claim that the secular is a sort of advanced form of religion. If it's true, though, then it subverts the entire basis of his argument, which is the sharp divide between religious and secular violence, right? So on and on, I show example after example of this kind of thing in the first chapter. So some religion and violence theorists solve this confusion by just openly expanding the category of religion to include all kinds of things that we usually consider to be secular. And so this is known as functionalism. If it functions like a religion, then it is one. So in his book, Why People Do Bad Things in the Name of Religion, Richard Wentz blames violence on absolutism, and he says that religion has a particular tendency towards absolutism. But he casts a very wide net when considering what religion is. Here are some of the things he includes under religion. Faith in technology, secular humanism, consumerism, football fanaticism. He's got this one great scene where he describes the kind of non-church-going auto mechanic who comes home and watches Monday night football and lets his belly open up his fly and arranges his sandwiches and his beers just so. And he describes this whole scene in Eucharistic overtones, and he describes this as being religion. And so he's compelled to conclude, perhaps all of us do bad things in the name of religion. Now, I think Wentz should be commended for his consistency in not trying to erect an artificial division between so-called religious and so-called secular types of absolutism. The price of consistency, though, is that he evacuates his own argument of any explanatory force or usefulness. So the word religion in the title of his book, Why People Do Bad Things in the Name of Religion, it ends up meaning anything that people do that gives their lives order and meaning, right? So a more economical title for the book would have just been Why People Do Bad Things, right? Because the word religion doesn't actually serve any useful analytic purpose. So Wentz, Hitchens, Jurgens Meyer, et cetera, they're not necessarily wrong to include so-called secular things in the category of religion. There's a vast literature on Marxism as a religion, for example, right? The book The God That Failed and so on, right? Does this not look religious, right? Compare. Right. I just love doing this, sorry. So there's an extensive body of scholarship as well that explores the prevalence of civil religion in the United States, which, as Robert Bella says, quote, has its own seriousness and integrity and requires the same care and understanding that any other religion does. He's talking about civil religion in the United States. Carolyn Marvin similarly argues, quote, nationalism is the most powerful religion in the United States and perhaps in many other countries, right? Nationalism is the most powerful religion in the United States. And scholars have explored this, the myths and the symbols and the sacrifices that surround the flag. This is the way American school children used to salute the American flag until Adolf Hitler made this gesture unpopular in the United States. But it's an arresting, and then it became hand over heart, but these images are really kind of arresting. This was actually the image that I asked Oxford University Press to put on the cover of the book, and they thought it would be a little bit too incendiary, so they put a different image on the book. The photo they put on the book is not bad, but it's not quite as arresting as this. These are American, not German school children. As well. Sorry. Anyway. How did he get in there? I don't know. Anyway. Come on, you miss him, don't you? More kind of examples of this. This is the image that if you go into the Capitol building in Washington, D.C. and look up into the dome, this is what you see. This is a painting done in the 19th century called the Apotheosis of Washington, literally the becoming God of Washington. And it's a picture of George Washington surrounded by all these mythological figures kind of ascending into heaven. So civil religion in the United States. More examples. In the wake of rolling blackouts in California, I don't know if you remember this, 2001, they deregulated the electrical industry in California and all hell broke loose and there were rolling blackouts and so on. One of the architects of the deregulation was the head of the business school at the University of Oregon. He was quoted in the New York Times expressing his belief that free markets always work better than state control. And he said, quote, I believe in that premise as a matter of religious faith, right, end quote. And so scholars who take a kind of functionalist approach to religion say, let's take him at his word, right? If it walks like a duck and quacks like a duck, it's a duck, right? It is a religion. So if you look at religious studies literature, you can find the following treated under the rubric religion: totems, witchcraft, human rights, Marxism, liberalism, Freudianism, Japanese tea ceremonies, nationalism, sports fanaticism, free market ideology, Alcoholics Anonymous, etc., etc. The list goes on and on. A federal judge actually declared Alcoholics Anonymous a religion in 2002. Now, let's stop for a minute. I can imagine an objection that's going through your mind, right? Saying, no. We all know that religion is really about belief in God or gods, right? All those other things are not really religious. If you take that approach, then you would have to eliminate certain belief systems that are usually called religions, like Taoism or Confucianism or many forms of Buddhism that don't have God or gods as a central concept. If the definition of religion is expanded to include those, you say, well, we got to include Buddhism, right? That's clearly a religion. So if you expand the definition, say, use some term like transcendence, right? So now we can include the Buddhists too. But if you use some more inclusive term like this, then all sorts of practices, including many that are usually labeled secular, fall under the definition of religion. Many institutions and ideologies that don't explicitly refer to God or God's function in the same way as those that do. So expanding the concept of religion to include godless Buddhism makes it difficult to exclude godless Marxism. Likewise, it's hard to imagine a better candidate for transcendence than nationalism, right? The term transcendence is a tool of Western scholars of religion who borrowed the term from the Judeo-Christian tradition, with its distinction between a creator God and a created world, on the other hand. To apply that term to Buddhism, which doesn't have any sort of distinction like that, you have to make transcendence really vague, right? But the vaguer you make it, then the more all of these other things include, and you have no justification for excluding things like nationalism from the definition of religion. So if terms like transcendence, the sacred, super empirical, and so on are made vague enough to be transcultural, then the exclusivity of the term religion breaks down very quickly. And that, I think, is particularly relevant to the question of violence. Right? Is there any good reason to suppose that people are more likely to kill for a god than for a nation? Right? You look out at the world and you say, some places yes, but in some places no, right? Take our own context, right? What if we ask two questions? What percentage of Americans who identify themselves as Christians would be willing to kill for their Christian faith or kill for Jesus? Not many, right? If you ask, on the other hand, what percentage would be willing to kill for their country, it seems clear that, at least among American Christians, right, the nation state is subject to far more absolutist fervor than Christianity. Most Christians would assume that under certain circumstances, it's your duty to kill for your country, right? The majority of American Christians consider public evangelization to be in poor taste, right? We hate it when somebody, you know, when a Jehovah's Witness comes knocking at the door, right? You pretend you're not home, right? But most endorse organized slaughter on behalf of the nation as sometimes necessary and often laudable, right? And I think we need to conclude then that there's no coherent way to isolate religious ideologies with a peculiar tendency toward violence from their tamer secular counterparts. So-called secular ideologies and institutions like nationalism and capitalism can inspire just as much violence as so-called religion. Now, let me entertain another objection that maybe is going through your mind, right? This sounds like hair splitting over definitions. But it's really nothing more complicated than what the Bible says about idolatry, right? What I'm saying here is not new. It's in your Bibles from cover to cover. The condemnation of idolatry, the basic idea in the Bible that people worship all kinds of things, right? They treat all kinds of things as gods. Golden calves, armies, mammon, even their own bellies, as Paul says to the Philippians 3:19, their gods are their bellies, right? The Bible, of course, teaches that there is one true God among the many false gods, but the Bible doesn't think there is one set of religious pursuits and another essentially different set of mundane or secular pursuits, right? That's why the Old Testament goes into so much detail about what to do with your bird's nests and your pots and pans and what to do when a donkey falls into a pit and what to do with water into which a dead weasel has fallen and things like that, right? Because all of your mundane things are, it's not a separate religious life, right? People in actual fact treat all kinds of things as gods, and so-called religious and so-called secular ideas and practices often function in the same way. And that, I think, is just a basic biblical insight. So the problem with Hitchens, then, is not just that he thinks Stalinism is a religion. The problem is that if he's going to use this expanded definition of religion, he should do so consistently, but he doesn't. For Hitchens, American civil religion is not religion. Only Soviet civil religion is, right? American civil religion for Hitchens is purely secular. So the religious secular distinction is really nothing more than the distinction between things Hitchens likes and things Hitchens doesn't like, right? And the problem, again, is not that the concept of religion has fuzzy edges. I'll get this objection sometimes. Yeah, sure, there's the concept of religion has fuzzy edges. So does every concept. Culture, right? Politics, right? The problem is not that the concept of religion has fuzzy edges. The problem is that, as it's used by these religion and violence theorists, the distinction between religious and secular is unjustifiably clear. It's exactly the opposite from the problem of the edges being too fuzzy. So certain belief systems like Islam are condemned, while certain others like nationalism are ignored. So my point here is not to argue either for or against this expanded functionalist definition of religion. I have no intention of trying to solve once and for all the debate between functionalists and substantivists, whether or not Confucianism or Marxism or free market ideologies are religions, for example. Because I don't think there is a once and for all definition of religion. My point is that religion is a category which is constructed in different ways in different times and places, and according to the interests of those who are doing the construction. To understand why there's so much confusion around the category of religion, we need to do some history. So that's the next thing that I'm going to do, the history of the term. So Charles Kimball's book, When Religion Becomes Evil, begins with the following claim. It is somewhat trite, but nevertheless sadly true, to say that more wars have been waged, more people killed, and these days more evil perpetrated in the name of religion than by any other institutional force in human history, end quote. Kimball doesn't give any evidence for this, but if he were to try to prove it, he would need a transhistorical and transcultural concept of religion that would be at least theoretically separable from other institutional forces over the course of history. So political institutions, for example, right? The problem is that there was no religion considered as something separable from politics until the modern era, and then in the modern West, right? This is the religion-politics distinction is a modern Western invention. The Romans had a term, religio, that we get our term religion from, but it didn't mean anything like what we mean by religion. There is no religion-politics distinction. How could there be when Caesar is a god, right? Did the Aztecs kill people? Were there bloody human sacrifices because of religion or because of politics? Well, the question doesn't make sense in the Aztec context. There is no distinction between religion and politics in the Aztec context. As Wilfred Cantwell Smith showed in his landmark 1962 book, The Meaning and End of Religion, religion as a discrete category separable from culture, politics, etc., is an invention of the modern West. He goes back and he does a historical study, a detailed historical study, the concept of religion. And he concludes that in pre-modern Europe, there was no significant concept equivalent to what we think of as religion. Right? The ancient Romans had this term religio, but it covered all kinds of civic duties and relations of respect that we would consider to be secular. So here's what Augustine says in the beginning of the 5th century. We have no right to affirm with confidence that religio is confined to the worship of God, since it seems that this word has been detached from its normal meaning, in which it refers to an attitude of respect in relations between a man and his neighbor. That's not at all what we mean by the term religion, right? There's no religious secular distinction going on here. In the medieval era, the religious secular distinction was a distinction between two kinds of Catholic priests, right? It didn't at all mean what we mean by it. The religious were those who belonged to an order, and the secular were those who belonged to a diocese, right? Catholics still talk about joining an order as joining the religious life, right? In the year 1400, according to the Oxford English Dictionary, the religions of England were the various orders, the Benedictines, the Dominicans, the Franciscans, and so on. There was no realm of secular pursuits to which God was indifferent. And though there was a distinction between civil and ecclesiastical authorities, there was no distinction between religion and politics as we conceive it. So this distinction, this religious-secular distinction as we know it today, was a creation of the early modern period. And it was a creation of struggles between the church and civil authorities. In the creation of the modern sovereign state between the 15th and the 17th centuries, I have a detailed history of this in the book, but I'm just going to do it in a couple sentences here. Religion was invented as a universal, essentially interior and private impulse that was essentially separate from politics and other so-called secular concerns. So henceforth, the church's proper area of concern would be essentially alien from politics, right? So in other words, you take all that the church is concerned with and you put it into this box called religion, which is something private, and that then allows the civil authorities to have free reign in the so-called public realm, right? Another modern distinction, public and private. The idea that religion is a transcultural and transhistorical impulse, then, is false, and it makes this separation of religion and politics appear natural and inevitable, but it's really just a contingent arrangement of power in society. So it takes place in Europe first between the 15th and the 17th centuries, and then it gets exported to the rest of the world in the process of colonization. So Smith's study concludes, quote, "There is no closely equivalent concept to religion in any culture that has not been influenced by the modern West," end quote. He goes looking for the concept of religion in ancient Greece, in Egypt, China, India, and he finds it nowhere in the ancient world. And in their initial encounters with the non-Western world, it's remarkable, European explorers go out and they report back with remarkable consistency that the natives have no religion at all. I've got a long list of these instances of explorers reporting back home that the natives have no religion. Once they're colonized, though, then suddenly we discover that they have religions after all. Religion becomes a powerful tool for categorizing the local cultures. How does this work? Let me give you one example. Hinduism, for example. Hinduism, which is a word that first appears in the 1780s, you've got Hindus before then, but we don't have Hinduism. Hinduism becomes a religion in the 19th century as it's being colonized by the British, right? Hinduism becomes a religion despite the fact that Hinduism encompasses everything it means to be Indian, right? Everything that we divide into culture and politics and religion and economy and so on. There's one scholar, Fritz Stahl, who says, quote, "Hinduism does not merely fail to be a religion, it's not even a meaningful unit of discourse," end quote. Now, this is not an insult to Hindus. What he's saying is that it's so big, it's the whole of Indian culture, it's like talking about Americanism, right? What does that mean? Well, it can mean a zillion different things, right? The classification of Hinduism, this big thing, into this little thing called religion, though, proves remarkably useful for the British. Because basically, if under British rule, Hinduism a religion, then to be Indian is to be private, and to be British is to be public, right? And that's a very short version of how this works, much more detail in the book. But this is why many contemporary, as in right now, advocates of Hindu nationalism refuse to call Hinduism a religion. So the powerful BJP, I think the ruling party in India right now, they reject the classification of Hinduism as a religion. Richard Cohen writes, quote, "The proponents of Hindutva, Hindu nationalism, refuse to call Hinduism a religion precisely because they want to emphasize that Hinduism is more than mere internalized beliefs. It's social, political, economic, familial in nature." And this struggle goes on all around the world. Similar reasons, Chinese nationalists at the end of the 19th, beginning of the 20th centuries, refused to categorize Confucianism and Taoism as religions, right? The Chinese government today They have a document 19. It's the official list of the five religions in China, and Confucianism is not one of them. Why? Because they say it's superior to religion. It's part of the national character. It's not a religion. Religion is private and otherworldly. So in her book, The Invention of World Religions, that title should say a lot, The Invention of World Religions, Tomoko Masusawa says, this concept of religion as a general transcultural phenomenon, yet also as a distinct sphere in its own right, is patently groundless. It came from nowhere, and there is no credible way of demonstrating its factual and empirical substantiality. Now, the only thing I think that she gets wrong there is that it didn't come from nowhere. It came from the West in the process of colonization. So in other words, the religious secular distinction is not engraved in the nature of things. It's a distinction that is employed by Western or Westernized societies to marginalize certain kinds of things, beliefs and practices, and to authorize other kinds of beliefs and practices. Let me give you some examples then in this last section of the talk of how that works, right? What's it for, right? If the argument is so incoherent, then why is it so prevalent, right? Well, the answer is because it's useful. So the last part of the myth of religious violence says that religion should be marginalized from public power, and we should fight to defend and spread secular ideals. So let's look at this. I'm going to give you some examples from the domestic sphere and some examples from foreign policy of how this myth is used. So well into the 20th century, religion, so first I'm going to talk about domestic, some Supreme Court cases. I went back and read every Supreme Court case that had to do with religion. And what you find is that up until 1940, religion is cited as a unifying force in American society. And from 1940 on, religion is cited as a divisive force in American society. It's really remarkable, this change. The first U.S. Supreme Court decision to invoke the myth of religious violence was Minersville School District versus Gobitis in 1940, which upheld compulsory pledging of allegiance to the American flag. So what the issue was whether or not Jehovah's Witnesses could refrain from saying the Pledge of Allegiance in schools. And so Justice Felix Frankfurter, in his decision, he writes, quote, centuries of strife over the erection of particular dogmas as exclusive or all-comprehending faiths led to the inclusion of a guarantee of religious freedom in the Bill of Rights. The First Amendment sought to guard against repetition of those bitter religious struggles by prohibiting the establishment of a state religion and securing to every sect the free exercise of its faith. Right? Bitter religious struggles in the past. This is the first instance I could find in the Supreme Court cases of the myth of religious violence. There's these bitter religious struggles. People kill each other over religion, so we need to marginalize it. So he says, Frankfurter says, securing to every sect the free exercise of his faith. Now, of course, then, he ruled that the Jehovah's Witnesses couldn't be forced to salute the American flag, which they thought was idolatry, right? Wrong. This is what he says. He says, the Jehovah's Witnesses' dissent threatened the promotion of national cohesion. We are dealing with an interest inferior to none in the hierarchy of legal values. National unity is the basis of national security. What the school authorities are really asserting is the right to awaken in the child's mind considerations as to the significance of the flag contrary to those implanted by the parent, right? And this is a good thing. So you could force Jehovah's Witnesses to salute the flag, right? The court reversed itself 3 years later, but Frankfurter had succeeded in introducing this idea that the First Amendment decisions could be made against the backdrop of some unspecified history of bitter religious struggles, the antidote to which is the enforcement of national unity, right? Now, Martin Marty discusses this case, Minersville versus Gobitis, and he cites the many instances in which Jehovah's Witnesses were attacked beaten, tarred, imprisoned, castrated, and so on in the United States in the 1940s because they refused to salute the flag. They considered it idolatrous, right? Now, one would think that, so here's an example of rioting against the Jehovah's Witnesses in St. Louis in 1940. Now, one would think, of course, that Marty would conclude, therefore, that zealous nationalism can cause violence. Astonishingly, Marty says, quote, "It became obvious that religion, which can pose us versus them, or them versus what we think the state should be or do, carries risks and can be perceived by others as dangerous. Religion can cause all kinds of trouble in the public arena." Right? Now, what Marty means by religion, right, is not extending one's arm or saluting the flag in this kind of ritual way. He means only the Jehovah's Witnesses' refusal to do so. Even though, of course, and so he says religion causes violence, right? Religion causes havoc, even though it was the Jehovah's Witnesses who were getting the crap beat out of them, right? Even though they were suffering the violence rather than perpetrating it. This is the way that the myth of religious violence tends to work. It tends to kind of turn things around in this way. And in the succeeding decades, the myth of religious violence would be invoked by the Supreme Court in case after case. So in decisions banning school prayer, forbidding voluntary religious instruction on public school property, forbidding state aid to parochial school teachers, and so on and so forth. When the court banned school prayer in the Abington case in 1963, again invoking the specter of religious violence, all of these decisions were made because religion is violent and so on. So Justice Potter Stewart dissented from that case, warning of, quote, "the establishment of a religion of secularism." Right, the establishment of a religion of secularism. Stewart noted, for example, the long history of government religious practice in the U.S., including the fact that the Supreme Court begins their sessions with "God save this honorable court," right? So a couple of his colleagues responded to him, Justices Goldberg and Harlan, and they addressed this objection by drawing a sharp line between patriotic invocations of God and religious ones. So here's what they say. "There is, of course, nothing in the decision reached here that is inconsistent with the fact that school children and others are officially encouraged to express love for our country by reciting historical documents, the Declaration of Independence, etc., anthems which include the composer's professions of faith in a supreme being, or with the fact that there are many manifestations in our public life of belief in God. Such patriotic or ceremonial occasions bear no true resemblance to the unquestioned religious exercise that the state has sponsored in this instance." Now, they don't give any reason why patriotic invocations of God bear no true resemblance to religious invocations. But it's clear that what separates religion from what's not religion is not the invocation of God, right? God can be invoked in public ceremonies without such ceremonies thereby becoming religious exercises, provided that such ceremonies express love for our country, right? So separating religion from non-religion in this case depends not on the presence or absence of expressions of faith in God, but on the presence or absence of expressions of faith in the United States of America, right? American nationalism is the antidote for religious divisiveness, and so revulsion to killing and dying in the name of one's religion, ironically then, is one of the principal means by which we become convinced that killing and dying in the name of America is laudable and proper. And that brings me to foreign policy. In foreign policy, the conventional wisdom, you hear it all the time these days, right? All the news about ISIS and so on. The conventional wisdom helps reinforce and justify Western attitudes and policies toward the non-Western world, especially the Muslims, right? Those crazy Muslims over there. They're different from us because they stubbornly refuse to tame religious passions in the public sphere. And so Hitchens, for example, he skewers religion for its violence, but he was an enthusiastic supporter of the Iraq War and Western military adventures in the Muslim world. Despite his attempt to recruit Martin Luther King to his side, Hitchens had some very approving things to say about killing people. Here's a quote from Hitchens. "And I say to the Christians while I'm at it, go love your own enemies, by the way. Don't be loving mine. I think the enemies of civilization should be beaten and killed and defeated, and I don't make any apology for it." End quote. For Hitchens, the Iraq War was part of a broader war for secularism. And for him, the game is zero sum. Quote, "It's not possible for me to say, well, you pursue your Shiite dream of a hidden imam, and I pursue my study of Thomas Paine and George Orwell, and the world is big enough for both of us. The true believer cannot rest until the whole world bows the knee." End quote. Now, the true believer he has in mind, of course, is the Muslim. But Hitchens' message is that the true believer in secularism can also not rest until the whole world has been converted to secularism by force, if necessary. One more example. Fellow new atheist Sam Harris, very famous author. He has a book about violence and irrationality of religion, and it dramatically illustrates this double standard. It's called The End of Faith. Harris, in the beginning of the book, condemns the irrational religious torture of witches, but he provides his own argument later in the book for torturing terrorists. And his book is charged with the conviction that the secular West cannot reason with religious people, but must deal with them by force. Here's what he says. "Some propositions are so dangerous that it may even be ethical to kill people for believing them. Certain beliefs place their adherents beyond the reach of every peaceful means of persuasion while inspiring them to commit acts of extraordinary violence against others. There is, in fact, no talking to some people," religious people. "If they cannot be captured, and they often cannot, otherwise tolerant people may be justified in killing them in self-defense. This is what the United States attempted in Afghanistan and what we and other Western powers are bound to attempt at an even greater cost to ourselves and innocents abroad, elsewhere in the Muslim world. We will continue to spill blood in what is at bottom a war of ideas." Now, his logic here is impeccable, right? If religious people hold these crazy beliefs so fervently that they will do violence for them, then there's no use trying to reason with them. They can only be dealt with by force. So the myth of religious violence becomes a justification for the use of violence. In a chapter entitled "The Problem with Islam," Harris writes, "In our dialogue with the Muslim world, we are confronted by people who hold beliefs for which there is no rational justification, and which therefore cannot even be discussed." You can't even talk to Muslims, right? "And yet these are the very beliefs that underlie many of the demands they are likely to make upon us," end quote. And this is especially a problem, he says, if such people gain access to nuclear weapons. There's little possibility of our having a Cold War with an Islamist regime armed with long-range nuclear weapons. In such a situation, the only thing likely to ensure our survival may be a nuclear first strike of our own. Needless to say, this would be an unthinkable crime, as it would kill tens of millions of innocent civilians in a single day. But it may be the only course of action available to us, given what Islamists believe. He goes on to say that Muslims would then likely misinterpret this act of self-defense as a genocidal crusade. I swear I'm not making this up. Thus plunging the world into nuclear holocaust. And so he says, all of this is perfectly insane, of course. I have just described a plausible scenario in which much of the world's population could be annihilated on account of religious ideas that belong on the same shelf with Batman, the Philosopher's Stone, and unicorns, right? So in other words, if we have to slaughter millions of people through a nuclear first strike, it's their fault and their crazy religious beliefs. Before we get to that point, though, Harris says, we must encourage civil society in Islamic countries, but of course we can't trust them to vote it in. And so he says, one more quote from Harris, "It seems all but certain that some form of benign dictatorship will generally be necessary to bridge the gap. But benignity is the key, and if it cannot emerge from within a state, it must be imposed from without. The means of such imposition are necessarily crude: economic isolation, military intervention, etc. While this may seem an exceedingly arrogant doctrine to espouse, gee, you think it appears we have no alternatives, right? Now, Harris's book is a particularly blunt version of this type of justification for violence, but he's by no means isolated. His book was a New York Times bestseller. It won the Penn Award for Nonfiction in the year 2005. It's enthusiastically endorsed by such academic superstars as Richard Dawkins and Alan Dershowitz and Peter Singer. Right? This is the same Peter Singer who doesn't think that it's justifiable to kill irrational animals for food. Apparently, killing irrational Muslims is a different thing. Indeed, Harris's logic is little different in practice from the Bush doctrine that America has access to liberal values that are, quote, right and true for every person in every society, end quote, and we must use our power to promote such values on every continent, and that America will take preemptive military action if necessary to promote such values. That's from the National Security Strategy issued in 2002. Now, to conclude then, I don't wish either to deny the virtues of liberalism or secular democracy, or to excuse the vices of other kinds of social orders. What I'm trying to do is level the playing field. Okay, what I'm trying to do is level the playing field. Leveling the playing field doesn't mean that the game's going to end in a tie. It just means that all the fouls are going to be called fairly, right? Leveling the playing field means that we can examine the violence, and we should examine the violence that can be generated and is generated by the concept of jihad, for example. But we should also examine the violence that can be generated by ideologies of free markets and free elections. So put simply, my argument is that people kill for all sorts of things. Things like money and flags and oil and freedom that function as gods in people's lives. So I want to challenge the religious-secular dichotomy that causes us to turn a blind eye to liberal forms of imperialism and violence. Insofar as the myth of religious violence creates the villains against which our social order defines itself, it's little different from previous forms of Western imperialism in which those people over there need to be made by force if necessary to be more like us. If the argument is taken seriously, I think it would neither vilify Western-style liberalism nor justify theocracy, but help us see that those are not the only two choices there are. We don't have to choose between Iran and Canada. Right? There are all sorts of other options out there. Violence feeds on the need for enemies, the need to separate us from them. And such binary ways of dividing the world make the world understandable for us, but unlivable for many. So doing away with the myth of religious violence is one way of resisting such binaries and perhaps turning some enemies into friends. Thank you.
Now we move to question and answer, and I invite students to come to either microphone and ask our speaker hard-hitting questions. Yeah, hold his feet to the fire.
Should I just turn this on or turn it off?
Hello, thank you for your speech today. My name is Stephen. I'm one of the. Are we on? Would you say that the conflict in Syria is unavoidable or not within a religious aspect for certain groups like ISIS going there? Or are they using their religion of Islam, trying to bring the area to an Islamic state? Is that more nationalism? Like, can you separate nationalism from religion, I guess?
Right, yeah, good question. So. The question, everybody heard the question?
No? Okay. The question is, in Syria, for example, the conflict that's going on there, can you separate out religion from nationalism? Can you call it a religious war? Can you call it a national war? What do you call it? Is that fair enough?
Fair enough.
Okay. Yeah, good question. That's probably the best example right now of what's commonly considered sort of religious war. So we like to kind of look at that and say, ha, those crazy people are over there killing each other again in the name of God and in the name of religion. And, you know, why can't they be more like us? And I think the situation is a lot more complicated than that. So I'm sorry, you want to follow up?
I just have a follow up. I think that having entire towns like beheaded on national television because they don't buy into the Muslim religion is religious violence.
Yeah.
Is there a separation between cutting your head off because you're not Muslim? Is that religious violence or is that some kind of nationalism? Because it seems to me like it's religious violence.
Yeah, I would call it Muslim violence.
Okay.
Right? I mean, that to me is a clear example where the Islamic faith is being used to promote violence.
Right.
And as I said right at the beginning of the talk, I mean, I have no intention of denying that that's in fact the case. There are Christians that have used in history, you know, Christian faith to justify violence in different ways, right? But why do I want to call it Muslim violence rather than religious violence? And the reason is because in Islam, separating out something called religion from something called national, you know, the kind of nation that they're trying to establish, or separating out religion from politics, just doesn't really make a whole lot of sense in the Islamic context. And so John Esposito, one of the leading scholars of Islam, he says that to say that Islam is a religion is already to mark it as an abnormal religion, because they don't make the kind of separation between religion and politics that we do. So we're imposing kind of foreign categories on that situation. And the reason, the practical, so there's a theoretical reason why I want to resist that and call it Muslim violence, but not religious violence in that sense. There's a theoretical reason. The practical reason that I want to resist that is because then it makes it seem as if because American involvement is not religious, that the causes of the war are completely kind of out of our hands, and it's just this sort of crazy, you know, thing that they've got going on over there, right? So 1979, the Ayatollah takes over Iran and the Islamic Revolution, and suddenly our television screens are filled with people in their bathrobes chanting death to the America and so on. And we wake up and we say, what's this? Who are these people? Why do they hate us, right? And the reason we like to tell ourselves is, well, they've had this crazy sort of religious experience, right? They're Shiites and they've just got some sort of crazy ideas, right? And what that allows us to do is cast a fog of amnesia on what had gone on for the previous 26 years, which was the rule of the Shah, right? Which was a secular regime and brutal, extraordinarily brutal, right? In 1953, Mohammad Mossadegh, democratically elected leader, was overthrown with the help of the United States and the British, and the Shah was imposed, and then for the next 26 years, his secret police, the Savak, killed and tortured thousands, tens of thousands of people, right? But we want to forget all that, right? We remember that the Ayatollah imposed an Islamic dress code when he took over in 1979. We forget that the first Shah imposed a secular dress code in 1924. Right? So it helps us to kind of create this amnesia. And the current situation is the same sort of thing. To view what's going on in the Middle East right now as if we have nothing to do with it and it's just these ancient religious hostilities that have broken out again is incredibly irresponsible, right? I mean, in a lot of ways, we didn't create that situation, but we made it lots worse by all the different kinds of intervention, the most recent obvious example being the invasion of Iraq in 2003. So that's the way I want it to kind of discipline our language so that we speak the truth about what's going on. And if you then level the playing field, then you begin to look at causes on both sides. And then you begin to ask wiser questions like, bombing the hell out of them didn't seem to do a whole lot of good the last time. Why do we think it's going to do a lot of good this time, right? Anyway, thank you.
Thank you.
Hi. I just wondered, not to create more us versus them ideas, but I was wondering if you could talk about like gender and what that role plays in religious violence.
What do you mean? Could you say?
Well, I mean,
just
violent trends are different between the way men do it and females do it, and I wonder if there's different trends between the way religious violence or just violence in general on this scale is done.
Yeah, that's an interesting question. I've been reading a lot about the history of violence recently, and there's an interesting book by a French scholar named, whose last name I'm going to butcher, but it's Muchemled, and I'm sure that's not the way it's pronounced in French, but he argues that gender is a much more determinative question in the formation of violence. I mean, for me, talking about religious violence and talking about secular violence is misleading from the start. That we don't gain anything analytically by dividing these things up into these two camps. Let's just talk about violence, right? What causes violence? When does, under what conditions does Muslim faith cause violence? Under what conditions does Christian faith cause violence? Under what conditions does capitalism cause violence? Under what conditions does liberal democracy cause violence, et cetera? Let's just talk about violence. And when you do talk about violence, over the history, you find that 90% of violence is done by young males, right? And so the whole question of gender then becomes much more relevant to these kinds of questions than this artificial distinction between religious and secular. Yeah, good question.
Thank you. I'd like to start off by saying thank you for your talk. I really enjoyed it.
Thanks.
Do you think that part of the reason why we feel like, as a secular nation, that those are Muslim people, they're crazy, or they're misogynistic, we're here, the Iraq War, the Afghanistan War, is also been cited as a war to save the brown women. We need to liberate them from their patriarchal, really sexist, really repressive, religious regimes. And we see images of, women being beheaded for adultery or having all these punishments, yet before the Taliban took over, which was funded by America to fight Soviet invaders. In the 1970s, 40% of doctors in Kabul were female, and there was a lot of female participation. Yet, by helping the most extreme kind of sections to help fight off other invaders, because we don't like communism more than we don't like Islam at the moment, that we kind of propagate this, if I'm making any sense.
Yeah, absolutely. I think so. No, thank you for that comment. I mean, I think that's right. What you're pointing to is the fact that violence is very hard to control. It's very hard to get the result that you want by blowing people's limbs off their bodies. And so an admirable desire to help people can oftentimes become, can morph into the opposite, right? And the example that you gave, of course, is the way that the United States funded the Mujahideen in Afghanistan to fight the Soviet Union, and the next thing they're kind of taking over Afghanistan and making life very difficult for women, and I think that's exactly right. The idea that we can come in and enforce peace through violence, how often has it worked, and how often can we control it? I think those are really good questions to ask. I think, American foreign policy has been called a kind of secularized version of Christian missionary movements. You know, Wilsonianism, the idea that we're going to go out and make the world safe for democracy, and we're going to turn the world into this peaceful place, and so on, has been seen as a kind of way of kind of secularizing the Christian impulse to go out and save the world. And that impulse has done good things, but it's done a lot of damage as well. And I always, you know, if anybody ever invites me to give a college commencement address, I'm going to stand up and say, for God's sake, don't go out and try to make the world a better place. Right? You know, the world has had enough of well-meaning middle-class Americans trying to make the world a better place, right? Go home, make your hometown a better place. This is why, of course, nobody's ever going to invite me to give a commencement speech, right? But there's a certain kind of humility, I think, that that we need to take to these issues, right? That if you're going to use violence, you better make darn sure that it's going to have the effects that you intended to affect, and that you don't put yourself in this kind of godlike position. Yeah.
Do you think the West has helped propagate radical Islam by helping, for example, training the Mujahideen, helping Saddam Hussein, helping, you know, radicals before they turned against the United States, and almost promoting this kind and promoting a kind of backlash, religious backlash as well?
Yeah, I'm not an expert on it, but people say that you know, the United States military actions has been the greatest recruiting tool for Islamic radicals. I think you can make the argument that ISIS would not exist if the U.S. hadn't invaded Iraq in 2003. Again, I'm not an expert on that, but...
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah.
Good talk. I kind of... I'm going to read what I wrote, and it's going to sound like it's several questions, but it leads to a one final question. So okay. I don't mean to like to tell you that. So if there is no real agreed upon definition of religion, but there is a distinction between nationalism and religious private practice, then in ancient times, is it safe to say that religion was a prominent and effective tool for political structure and or reinforcement, in your opinion? And if so, then is it appropriate to say that nationalism is an evolved form of religion in the sense that it has taken the place of traditional religion as an effective political tool due to the advancement of technology and or science which challenges traditional conventional religion?
Thank you. Yeah, no, I think it makes sense. So the question is, has nationalism taken the place of traditional religion?
Yes, because I understand it in ancient times, like religion was used as sort of, you know, the political power enforcement, or stood in a centerpiece of political structure. So, in this sense, has it evolved? Has nationalism kind of taken the place that religion has in terms of a powerful political tool?
Yeah, okay. So, I mean, I would want to be cautious about this idea that religion was doing things in the ancient world, because I don't think that there was such a thing in the ancient world. I think it's a modern invention, this religious-secular dichotomy. But the point about nationalism, I think, is exactly right. My last book is called Migrations of the Holy, and what I'm arguing there, that's a phrase I borrow from the historian John Bossy, and what I'm arguing there is that the sacred, the holy, kind of migrates from the church to the nation state in the course of, you know, from the 16th century to the 19th, so that you get the situation where people are much more willing to kill for their country than they are to kill for Jesus or whatever. And that's some of the examples that I was giving of this kind of creation of a kind of civil religion. And that's why Carolyn Marvin says that nationalism is the most powerful religion in the U.S. and in many other countries. Yeah.
Well, I meant to say Middle Ages, because would that be more appropriate to say is like religion was used as a tool for sort of power and political control in the Middle Ages then? Or
I still would resist that, just because, again, the religious secular distinction in the Middle Ages was a distinction between two different kinds of priests.
Okay.
right? So, I mean, what you could say is something like the civil and ecclesiastical authorities were densely intertwined in the medieval period, and I think that's exactly right. But the creation of the religious-secular distinction comes out of a battle between the religious and between the civil and ecclesiastical authorities for power, right? The civil authorities gain the upper hand in modernity, and that's what characterizes modernity, basically by saying, here's this thing called religion, it's something private, you church people, you go do that.
Okay, well, that's what I meant then.
Yeah, okay, thank you. Good. Yeah, no, good, good job.
Hello, and once again, I just want to say thank you for the wonderful talk.
Oh,
and I guess my question involves, you stated earlier in this presentation that modernity within the past century or so marked a turning point in which religion became seen as a malevolent force, where previously it was seen as a force of good. And I just was curious to, I wanted to know if you could further discuss and explore the factors that caused this paradigm shift.
Yeah, good question. So that's actually, it's something that there's a, oh gosh, I can't remember his name. Oh, Geddix. Frederick Geddix is a legal scholar who's done some work on this, and I don't think he's got a definitive answer yet, but the claim was a little bit more specific. It was about the Supreme Court cases, that up until the 1940s, the Supreme Court saw religion as a unifying factor and afterwards as a divisive factor. And what Geddix argues is that this has several causes, and one of which is the secularization of American legal education from the founding of Johns Hopkins and other secular, explicitly secular universities in the late 19th century. Certain trends in legal education, like critical, not exactly critical theory, but secularizing trends in specifically in legal education, but then a kind of more general trend amongst intelligentsia, I guess, of looking towards an Enlightenment model from Europe for higher education, and not to a kind of more, all of the universities up until the late 19th century in the US were founded by religious communities, right, as being a kind of education in civic virtue, and not in this kind of Wissenschaftlich, German kind of Enlightenment ideal of objective secular learning and so on. So changes happening in American society, which happened first at the level of the intelligentsia, and then eventually kind of filter down to the rest of us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I was just wondering if you could clarify on something that you had talked about. You talked about how the Jehovah's Witnesses had refused or didn't wish to do the flag salute based off of their own beliefs and everything. But, and you talked about how the nationalists fought with them about that and everything. But you had said that it wasn't a religious fight because the nationalists were fighting, they began the fighting. But at one point in this presentation, you had mentioned that nationalism was the most powerful religion in the US.
Yeah.
And so I just thought that that was sort of a contradiction, and I was wondering if you could clarify that.
Right, right. When Carolyn Marvin says that nationalism is the most powerful religion in the United States, she's using this term religion in what's called a functionalist way, which means if it walks like a duck and quacks like a duck, it's a duck, right? So capitalism is a religion, nationalism is a religion, Marxism is a religion, and so on, right? That's called functionalism, right? Substantivism is what we're used to, a kind of more restricted definition of religion as something like belief in God or gods, and then you got a short list of, Islam and Buddhism and Christianity and so on. I don't fall into either one of those camps. So what I'm trying to do is show how flexible the term is, right? Some people will say nationalism is a religion. Some people are utterly convinced of that, and other people say no, it's not, because they don't worship God, right? And the people on the functionalist side says it doesn't matter if they worship God or not, it's acting like one, right? I belong to a third camp. See, I think the problem with the functional, the problem with the substantivists is obvious. The problem with the functionalists is that they still believe there's something called religion out there. They just have a bigger definition. So I belong to a third camp called constructivism, which basically says, look, there is no once and for all definition of religion, right? Religion is this invented term. The religious secular dichotomy is this invention. And it gets used, you know, where the division gets put in different places for different purposes at different times, right? So when you take that point of view and then you kind of level the playing field and say, let's do away with this category for a minute and then see what happens, right? And when you do away with it, then suddenly the playing field becomes level. So nationalism behaves an awful lot like, you know, Islam or Christianity under certain circumstances. And so now that you've gotten rid, at least temporarily, of this religious secular distinction, now you can do some real analytical work and say, aha, isn't it interesting that they're all acting in the same sort of way? I don't care if you call them a religion or not, right? And that to me is just a basic, again, biblical insight that people worship all kinds of things as if they were gods. So that's the kind of point I'm trying to make. So thanks for helping to clarify.
Yeah, thank you.
Sure.
We have time for two more.
Huh? All right.
Two more, and then we'll go out and continue the conversation.
Okay.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi. So in an historical context, when discussing religious violence, how do you explain the various wars waged in the name of a belief system, namely the Crusades? How is violence based in the convert or die methodology a myth versus actual realized violence? Is it because of a lack of definition of religion itself?
Yeah, okay, so good question. So I'm not saying that the Crusades are a myth, right? I mean, clearly, just to say it again, clearly there are lots of instances in which people use Christianity, for example, as an ideology to support violence, right? No question about that, right? The Inquisition, you know, the Crusades, you can bring a lot of the kind of basic, you know, the usual boogeyman up. And they're real, right? Maybe in some cases the legend gets exaggerated, but it's real, right? The question is whether you can say that those things are, in some sense, peculiarly religious in the sense of there's something separable out from politics and other things called religion that's inherently more violent than other so-called secular ideologies and institutions, and that's what I'm denying, right? And so again, what I'm trying to do is kind of level the playing field. So we say, yeah, here's an instance, the Crusades, in which Christianity is used to promote violence, and that's a bad thing, right? But let's also look at the ideology of free markets and free elections and the havoc that wreaks in Latin America, you know, in the late 19th century and into the 20th century. And let's look at that as well. So that's the point.
Oh, thank you.
Sure.
Okay, I'll be the last one. Hi. This notion of going back a few hundred years and then saying the definition of religion, using that as a basis instead of using it in the context of how people use it today, I think is a little bit of a shift that I didn't appreciate, okay? Religion is, when you say that it's not more troublesome in violence, I wouldn't say it's more, but it's the thing that you skip is when people create a narrative in their life that they live on and they depend on for some kind of mental security or physical security, and it's substantially grounded in superstition, that is a little hard to work with. I mean, we live in a world of that we're asked to respect a certain form of schizophrenia, And, you know, when you walk around and you try to work with the schizophrenic person who has a reality that nobody else can ever find, they are hard to communicate with. I don't think you were very fair to Sam Harris. I think he has many distinctions that you kind of failed to mention, but I'm not here to defend Sam Harris, but I'm here to say that when this audience thinks of religion, I don't think they go back and say, oh, that's right, it was the way a religion was in the 6th century or the 8th century. We look at it as we are today. And there are people, our era has its own kind of gods. I know the gods change, even the same word. Our gods are not the same as they were even for our grandparents. So they do shift. But the parts of them that depend on, the parts of our lifestyles and arguments that depend on one side being able to use superstition, where you can't go back and collect data, that's a stopper. That stops the conversation. And I think you have to address that. And when conversations stop, there is more violence.
Okay, thank you. What stops conversation is a really good thing to concentrate on, because I think what stops conversation is when you assume that the people that you're talking to are inherently irrational and they're not worth talking to, right? And that's basically Sam Harris's point about Muslims. And he thinks the same way about Christians and anybody else who believes in God, right? That this is an irrational superstition. There's no proof for the existence of God. And so you can't even talk to these people because they're irrational. So what you call superstition, of course, is always, I mean, it's a very loaded term. And it's a very subjective term, right? Superstition means I don't believe what you believe, and what you believe is stupid, right? And that, to me, is... that's what stops the conversation, you know. Whether you believe in God or whether you don't believe in God, the fact that maybe 85% of the human population does, maybe it's 90%, certainly more throughout history, believe in a God or of some kind. To dismiss all of those people as just being stupid or irrational is a recipe for violence, I think. I mean, What stops violence is the ability to entertain the position that the other person has as if they were a human being with something to say about the way the world is, right? And you may believe that there is no God, right? But to treat people who do believe in God as if they just are believing in the tooth fairy or something, as Richard Dawkins has said, you know, many times, you know. He doesn't need to know anything about theology, he says, because he doesn't need to know anything about fairies either, because he doesn't think that fairies exist. And so you just dismiss people out of hand. That, to me, is what stops conversations and makes things more difficult.
I guess I am stopping this conversation right here in front of all of you, but Professor Cavanaugh and I are going to go right through that door and around the corner, and we can continue this conversation over some refreshments. Maybe you'll buy a book or two that he has for sale. Thank you all very much for coming. The next lecture in this series is October 21st. Write it down. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you.